Our next speaker is Professor Matthew Fisher. Professor Fisher is Assistant Professor of Economics at Ivy Tech Community College in Fort Wayne, Indiana. He is a graduate of Michigan State University, the University of Dallas, and the University of Detroit Mercy's Master of Arts in Economics program. He will be speaking today on the revival of mercantilism. Professor Fisher.
Thank you, for Professor Weglarz, and thank you, Harry. Thank you all for coming. The title of my talk is The Revival of Mercantilism, and I think we're going to get a lot of this today on this topic. But in a 1993 interview, the economist Robert Lucas was asked what subjects he saw on the horizon, frontier of economics in the 1990s. His response was that in economic policy, the frontier never changes. The issue is always mercantilism and government intervention against laissez-faire and free markets. And that's exactly what's on the frontier right now with the new administration. How mercantilist are they going to be? We don't know. Although Lucas was referring to the Clinton administration, which was only 6 months old at the time, his words, I think, are just as applicable today. Many non-specialists have a pretty good idea about what economists refer to when they speak of the free markets. However, mercantilism, which was the dominant mode of economic thinking from the 15th to the late 18th century, is not nearly as well understood by the public. In this talk, I would like to present a brief overview of mercantilism and then consider certain claims made by present-day skeptics of free international trade. So allow me to first isolate what I consider to be three core mercantilist beliefs. Number one, trade is zero sum. In every trade, one side wins, the other side loses. Ludwig von Mises coined this belief the Montaigne dogma, after Michel Montaigne. Montaigne held that the gain of one man is the loss of another, and that no man makes a profit except at the expense of another. Montaigne also held that the same principle applies to trade between nations. Number two, resources ought to be used to promote the wealth, power, and prestige of the nation states. Number three, specie is wealth. If this is the case, then a nation state becomes wealthy through a current account surplus, or what's popularly known as a positive balance of trade. If you sell the rest of the world more stuff than the rest of the world sells you, then you have a net inflow of specie, which in turn promotes the wealth, power, and prestige of the nation states. Mercantilist notions led to a frenzy of exploration in search of raw commodities throughout the early modern era. Eventually, the major European powers established colonies in Africa, the Americas, Australia, and Asia. The colonies would send in raw materials, and the mother country would export finished goods abroad in exchange for gold. In order to enforce this mechanism, mercantilist nations turned toward more top-down, centrally managed economic systems. They became planned economies. And of course, if a nation wanted to sell its goods in the international market, it would need to be competitive, which among many other things means you need low costs of production. This is how slavery came back with the vengeance. The result of the planned economies that mercantilist nations adopted was a plethora of subsidies, legal monopolies, and tariffs. The regimes of Henry VIII and Elizabeth I in England and Louis XIV in France are particularly notable for their mercantilist tendencies and policies. Anyway, as time went by, movements toward political and economic freedom grew and began to supplant the mercantilists. Theologians associated with the School of Salamanca, the physiocrats in France, the Scottish moral philosopher Adam Smith and his followers in England, and several others successfully critiqued the core mercantilist doctrines, and in the 19th century, mercantilism was generally supplanted in the West by a movement toward laissez-faire. My purpose in this talk is not to dive into economic theory, although that will be unavoidable at points, but rather to investigate certain claims that are frequently made in public discourse with respect to international trade. These claims represent what I consider to be a kind of revival of mercantilist thinking. Underlying these claims are the core mercantilist beliefs I outlined right here. Now, I'm certain that you will recognize all the claims that I'm about to present. However, as I turn my focus away from economic history and toward our contemporary economy, I will mostly leave the connective tissue as an exercise to listen. So number one, international trade costs Americans jobs. Well, international trade has exploded in the last 56 years. There are periodic dips, and these correlate with the boom and bust cycle, but nothing here is what we didn't already know. We're not seeing anything new here. We all know that this is the case. But what of the claim that this has cost Americans jobs? Well, sadly, such a claim is about as common as it is inaccurate. There simply is no evidence to support it in U.S. employment trends. In general, you can see that total employment rises over time. The periodic decreases we see are, again, positively correlated with the business cycle. But the long-run upward trend is very clear. But maybe it's not international trade per se, but rather a trade deficit that causes job losses. This, after all, is what mercantilists were particularly interested in. So it's generally accepted that the United States has run a trade deficit, or more accurately, a current account deficit, every year since 1976. This is, that is to say, that the U.S. has imported more goods and services than it has exported every year for going on 41 years. The total of this imbalance between imports and exports over this period equals over $11 trillion U.S. dollars. That is, we've imported $11 trillion worth of goods more than we've exported since 1976. And yet, here you can see that since the mid-1970s, the current account has gone further into deficit, but all the while, the total number of persons employed in the U.S. increases. Indeed, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, there were 77 million people employed in the United States in January of 1976. As of November of 2016, there were 146 million people employed in the U.S. That's a 90% increase in jobs in the 40 years since the U.S. has run a continuous current account deficit. Now, some might argue that yes, the total number of jobs has increased, but what about the proportion of the workforce that is able to find employment? Might it be the case that the increase in jobs is not keeping pace with the increase in population, such that the total number of jobs obscures the fact that there are still many people out of work owing to the trade deficit? Don't we need to account for workforce participation rates? Well, the story doesn't change if we do that. According to the BLS, the labor force participation rate has actually increased from 61.3% to 62.9% over the same period. And as a matter of fact, just by eyeballing the chart, you can see several distinct periods of negative correlation between these data sets. For example, look at the blue line, which represents employment. Just prior to 2010, you can see a nice dip. That's what we call the Great Recession. However, you can also see that during this period in which Americans were losing jobs, the current account deficit was also falling. That is, the green line is moving upward towards surplus. So as the number of jobs in the economy was declining, the current account was moving closer to positive territory. This correlation runs in the opposite direction of that supposed by neo-mercantilist thinking. However, what if we restrict our analysis to manufacturing employment? Well, this is where things get a little more interesting. So much of our public discourse seems to take for granted that manufacturing jobs are a proxy for good-paying jobs. While this is not very accurate, I'll use this proxy for convenience's sake. So, does the current account deficit cost us good-paying jobs in the form of manufacturing jobs? Well, if you look at manufacturing employment in the U.S. since 1940, you'll notice that it peaks at just over 19 million in 1979, but since that time has been on a rather steady trend downward. At the height of the Great Recession, manufacturing employment fell to just over 11 million, and today it's right around 12.5 million. So there definitely is a correlation here between the total number of people employed in manufacturing and the current account deficit. Once we began running persistent current account deficits, that is buying more from the world than it buys from us, it was not long until manufacturing employment began its steady downward movement. Moreover, notice that both the the deficit and manufacturing employment figures are at their steepest right around the year 2001. This, as many have pointed out, is when China was admitted to the World Trade Organization. Admittance to the WTO gave Chinese producers official access to markets that were previously off-limits and or cost-prohibitive. If we look at Chinese manufacturing employment against U.S. manufacturing employment of the 2000s, another very clear picture emerges. From 2003 to 2014, Chinese manufacturing employment roughly doubled, from 40 million to just under 80 million. Over this same period in which Chinese manufacturing employment doubles, U.S. manufacturing employment falls by almost 20%. Now, one may stop here and conclude that a current account surplus, such as what China has with the U.S., causes an increase in manufacturing employment, while a current account deficit, which is what we in the U.S. have with the Chinese, causes a decrease in manufacturing employment. One might also conclude, and many have, that the manufacturing jobs we've lost, jobs that were at one time sufficient to support middle-class families, have been replaced merely by, say, service sector jobs, which do not pay wages sufficiently high to support middle-class families. But is it really true that the current account deficit causes Americans to lose good-paying jobs? Is our middle class being hollowed out for the sake of cheap TVs and smartphones? The fact of the matter is that the correlation between employment in a given sector and the status of the current account is not so simple. Why not? Well, if the claim that trade deficits cause job losses and trade surpluses cause job gains is true, then we should expect to see this general pattern emerge in other industries and countries, not just with respect to U.S. and Chinese manufacturing. But does it emerge elsewhere? Well, let's look at U.S. agriculture. Since 1960, the United States has exported $820 billion of food more than it has imported. We are the Saudi Arabia of food. But more to the point, there were over 10 million people employed on U.S. farms in 1950. But as of 2010, after years and years of massive agricultural trade surpluses, there were just over 3 million people employed on U.S. farms. So at the same time that we've had a growing agricultural trade balance, we've exported far more food than we've imported for going on six decades. Farm employment in the U.S. has fallen by 70%. I ask you, if a positive balance of trade in a given sector causes growing employment in that sector, then why has the U.S. shed so many agricultural jobs? Now, one might argue that while agriculture is not manufacturing, farm workers tend to earn very low wages, and we're more interested in those higher-paying, middle-class types of jobs. Well, with respect to manufacturing employment in particular, the current situation in Germany is very instructive. For example, take a look at the German current account. You can see here that unlike in the U.S., the Germans have been running consistent trade surpluses. As a matter of fact, in 2016, which this graph doesn't show, the Germans had the largest current account surplus of any country in the world at $297 billion, million U.S. dollars. The 2016 German current account surplus was even larger than the Chinese current account surplus. Now, since the theory we're considering here predicts that there will be an increase in manufacturing employment with an increase in the current account surplus, then we should expect to see the Germans gaining manufacturing jobs over the period during which they've run this current account surplus. But guess what? That's not at all the case. At the same time that the Germans have run the largest current account surplus in the world, German manufacturing employment has been on a downward trend. It was over 8.6 million in 2000, but falls to 7.8 million by 2014. That's a 9% reduction in the total number of people employed in manufacturing in Germany. Now, my question here is the same as it was with respect to the U.S. agricultural balance of payments. If current account surpluses really do lead to increases in manufacturing employment, then why on earth is Germany shedding manufacturing jobs? At the same time that they've had consistently large current account surpluses, the total number of people employed in German manufacturing has clearly fallen. But why? Well, the answer is that despite simple appearances here in the U.S., manufacturing employment, just like farm employment, doesn't have much of anything to do with the current accounts. Instead, it has to do with better educated workers who working with more technologically advanced capital goods. More highly skilled workers working with more sophisticated machinery means more output per worker, which in turn means fewer workers are required to complete a given task. Today, we simply don't need as many hands to produce factory outputs or provide the food we eat. Now, this state of affairs, I admit, that I'm outlining here is a little solace to some. After all, who cares if it's a Chinese factory worker or a robot that took your job? If you're out of a job, then you're out of a job, and it's no comfort to the unemployed that it was a CNC machine in Texas and not a factory hand in Jiangsu who took that job. However, there's another way of looking at the situation. To help my students see this other way, to show them the Marshallian imagination, I often ask my students to imagine a plot of land that is worked by 100 subsistence farmers. I ask them to suppose that each worker labors for 16 hours a day and produces just enough food so that he can remain in existence as a laborer of the farmland. Suppose, however, that one of the workers, and we'll call him Eugene, decides to work a 15-hour day instead. And during the 16th hour in which Eugene abstains from farming, he produces a capital good. Suppose that with the labor of only one worker, this capital good produced by Eugene is capable of providing enough food to adequately feed 100 people. I ask my students if this makes the other 99 farmers better or worse off. Some say no, because it means that these 99 people are out of a job. What are they? On the one hand, Eugene, our farmer-turned-capitalist, has this terrific bounty of food out of which many mouths can be fed. But supposing that you're one of the 99, are you really out of a job? What's stopping you from continuing work as a farmer? In reality, all that's changed is that you're now faced with a choice. You can continue to consume the food that you produce at a subsistence level, or you can attempt to consume the food produced by Eugene's capital good. But how might you go about this second option? Well, naturally, you could steal it from Eugene, but let's leave that to the side. Remember, we stipulated that these are subsistence farmers. Previously, they were able to produce nothing but the food. But we all know that our desire for material objects does not end with food. For we also desire clothing, shelter, bedding, medicines, books, musical instruments, wine, economics blogs, bourbon, rack of lamb. Maybe that's just my list of material desires. Feel free to substitute your own. The point remains. Does Eugene not have desires beyond mere sustenance? Why not ask him what he might also like in addition to the food? Maybe you can find a way to produce that item and then trade it to Eugene for some of that food. After all, he's got a lot more than he can eat. And perhaps you're more of the bookish type. Farming didn't really suit you to begin with. Or maybe you're good with an axe and would prefer cutting down oak trees to planting seeds by hand. See, with the addition of Eugene's capital good, the labor of these 99 people is freed up to pursue options which were previously foregone. Previously, they simply didn't have enough resources to do all this other stuff. They were forced by necessity to farm. Are these people really out of a job, or have their options merely changed? There are still plenty of things to do after all. So again, I ask, in what world are we wealthier? The world in which it takes the labor of 100 people to produce the food, or the one in which it takes only Eugene, while the rest are freed up to cut down oak trees, turn them into barrels, and fill them with bourbon or wine? I, for one, would not happily give up single-barrel bourbons for a 16-hour workday on the farm. Think about all the wonderful things we would be forced to sacrifice if all we did was work on farms. I'm not willing to make those sacrifices personally. Okay, fine, but you might object. What if machines became so far advanced that they put us all out of jobs? Well, this is the same thing as asking, what if machines produced everything we could ever possibly want in an unlimited quantities? If that should ever be the case, then welcome to utopia, my friends. If machines can produce everything we could ever possibly want and in unlimited quantities, and there was thus no need for anyone to labor at all, then why on earth should we be worried about jobs? Anyway, better educated workers working with more sophisticated machinery is the dominant reason why we see declines in employment in American farming as well as German and American manufacturing. The correlation between the increase in the current account deficit and the decline of manufacturing and employment in America is more or less a coincidence. Now, if what I'm claiming is correct, then we should in some sense be wealthier today than when more people worked in manufacturing. But is this really the case? After all, many people on both the right and the left argue that middle-class incomes have stagnated since the 1970s. The evidence they cite is simple. When we adjust median household income by the Consumer Price Index, we see no gain in that income over the last 45 years. These claims will very often come hand-in-hand with dour charts such as this, which purport to show that while the productivity of the American worker has been increasing, real wages have more or less completely flattened since sometime in the 1970s. But as a matter of fact, I'm pretty sure this claim is totally wrong. And although the issue may appear somewhat tangential to my discussion here, it is vitally important, as hopefully you'll see by the end. My claim is going to be that incomes in the U.S. have been rising since the 1970s, and long before that, for that matter. Now, to be sure, there are plenty of things that are legitimate worries in our present economy. And indeed, many things are getting worse as we speak. The fiscal outlook of our country, birth rates in the developed world, out-of-wedlock birth rates in the developed world, the economic illiteracy of the public, and many economists for that matter. These are very real problems, growing worse by the day. But I ask you, why needlessly add to the pile of worries with something about which we need not worry? The fact of the matter is that with respect to our material conditions, we are far wealthier today than we were 45 years ago. The economist Donald Boudreau has done a wonderful job of literally cataloging this progress. At his blog, Cafe Hayek, and elsewhere, Boudreau has mined old Sears catalogs and compared the prices within them to present prices at Sears.com. Rather than rely on flawed price indices such as the CPI or the PCE, which tend to overstate inflation, Boudreau takes the earnings of an average non-supervisory worker in 1975 and looks at how many hours that worker had to work at such a wage in order to purchase various goods from a Sears catalog published that year. Boudreau then looks at the earnings of an average non-supervisory worker in 2012 and how many hours that worker had to work to purchase the January 1st, 2013 equivalents at Sears.com. In both 75 and 13, Boudreau looked for the cheapest options for all goods. Here are some of his findings. A manual treadmill in 1975, at that average non-supervisory wage, he had to work 18 and a half hours. In 2013, 6.5 hours. Adult athletic shoes, 2 hours in 1975, 1 hour in 2013. Adult jeans, 1.4 hours to 1 hour. A 19-inch color television, 60.6 hours in 1975 to 6.6 hours in 2013. A 30-inch kitchen, all-electric range slash oven in 1975, 32.8 hours, in 2013, 18.6 hours. Frost-free refrigerator freezer, smaller one for 65.7 hours in 75, larger one for 20.4 hours in 13. A standard washer-dryer combo, 67.7 hours down to 29.9. Now this is just a sampling, of course, but you can see that the average wage of $19.84 an hour in 2012 goes much farther than the average wage of $4.87 an hour in 1975. Notice also that there's no adjustment for quality in Boudreau's analysis. In reality, the 2013 television, for example, which cost one-tenth the labor time of the 1975 television, is of an incomparably higher quality when compared to its 1975 equivalent. But Boudreau's analysis does not touch on every aspect of our lives as consumers. It couldn't. For example, there are many other items that we can't possibly compare. Items such as digital cameras, lightweight waterproof sportswear, recorded Hollywood movies to play at home, personal computers, smartphones, soft contact lenses, GPS devices, none of these were even in existence in 1975, yet they are staples of middle-class life today. Okay, that's all great. But I must admit, while this paints a very rosy picture, there are still other items which have gotten more expensive over the same period. The three big ones, education, healthcare, and housing. Now, space restricts me from a more complete analysis of these items, but unlike the other consumer goods mentioned above, education, healthcare, and housing are especially notable for the amount of local, state, and especially federal government intervention in their various markets. The economist Arnold Kling often points out that governmental intervention into a given market usually, if not always, takes one or both of the following forms. subsidy to demand and or restriction on supply. Let's think about subsidies first. A major subsidy to education, for example, is the Higher Education Act of 1965, which is the basis for many of today's post-secondary education subsidies, including student loans, Pell Grants, college library aid, on and on and on. Such policies make the demand for higher education greater than it otherwise would be, which puts upward pressure on the price of education. Subsidies to housing include everything Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac have ever done, the entire Department of Housing and Urban Development, the mortgage interest deduction, and a litany of other policies. These two shift the demand curve to the right, but this time for housing. Subsidies to health care include Medicare, Medicaid, guaranteed issue under the Affordable Care Act, and again, a host of other items, and these have the same predictable effects on demand curves. But then on top of this, there are also governmentally imposed restrictions on supply in all three of these markets. In education, you have accrediting associations, which, unless your school has their blessing, they're not visiting right now, right? Okay. It can't accept federal financial aid to pay for tuition. In healthcare, unless you have the blessing of the Accreditation Council for Graduate Medical Education Residency Review Committee, an organization which has the power by law to admit or not admit new residents in training in medicine, you will not become a practicing physician. Residency review committees, by the way, are comprised of incumbents in the healthcare sector, which is kind of like giving McDonald's the legal right to veto Burger King's plans to open up next door. You're going to get fewer hamburgers as a result. And unless you have the approval of the local zoning authorities who are elected and are appointed by incumbent owners, then good luck getting that new housing development off the ground. This particular restriction is rampant on both coasts of our country and a large reason why housing is so expensive in our major cities. The aggregate effect of all these subsidies to demand and restrictions on supply is to raise the prices of the goods and services traded in those markets. Nothing more and nothing less. And this is exactly, of course, what incumbents in those sectors want. So while it is certainly true that the prices of housing, healthcare, and schooling have risen, this has not been as a result of the inefficiency of the free market, let alone the current account deficit with China, of all things. They've risen because of public policies which subsidize consumers and restrict suppliers. The simple fact that our government has absurd policies does not mean that we no longer have good-paying jobs in the economy. All it means is that the winners of popularity contests and their friends place a lot of unnecessary impediments on markets. But given this mess, to turn back to the subject matter here, why on earth should we ask politicians to step in and regulate international trade more so than they already do? What makes you think that will work to our benefit? The fourth belief, the American manufacturing sector is being hollowed out. Well, one can't listen to 15 minutes of news radio or watch 10 minutes of the cable news network without hearing or seeing someone wring their hands over this one. But the fact is, we produce more stuff today than we ever have in the history of the country. Between 59 and 2005, the economy grew at 4.5 times, American manufacturing output grew 4.7 times, we produced twice as much stuff as we did in 1984, manufacturing is the largest part of our economy. We produce all sorts of stuff, cars, airplanes, telecommunications equipment, processed foods and beverages. And finally, there's a very popular claim that our current account deficit with China is caused by currency manipulation on behalf of the Chinese Central Bank. The story goes something like this. We buy so much, as I've already said, we buy so much more from the Chinese than they buy from us. This happens because the People's Bank of China, this is the belief, that the Chinese equivalent of the Federal Reserve, manipulates the value of the yuan, keeping it artificially low in terms of dollars. They do this by printing up yuan to create demand for the excess dollars that Chinese producers are holding after forex swaps every month. When they do this, the People's Bank of China keeps the price of the dollar from falling in the market. Instead, the yuan is inflated, which keeps goods denominated in yuan artificially cheap to American consumers. Keeping the purchasing power of the dollar artificially high allows Americans to continue to buy cheap stuff at Walmart, but as a consequence, Chinese factory workers end up making all the cell phones and we in America have fewer domestic jobs. Now this is a cute story, and I've already addressed certain parts of it, but for at least the last 2 years during which we in America have run record trade deficits with the Chinese, the People's Bank of China has been doing the exact opposite of this. While it's true that they intervene in forex markets, the problem for the contemporary mercantilist account is that the Chinese Central Bank intervenes on the other side of the trade. That is, the Currently, the People's Bank of China is selling dollar-denominated assets to purchase yuan. They're not at all printing up yuan to buy dollars. They're pushing back against the falling yuan and have been doing so for some time now. They've spent over $1 trillion since 2015 defending the yuan. Allow me to suggest in closing something which might seem nonsensical or at least counterintuitive to a mercantilist. We have a current account deficit in America not because of unfair trade practices such as Chinese currency manipulation. We have a current account deficit because foreigners wish to invest in the United States of America. I grant that this is not something you're likely to hear out of the mouth of our president, but that doesn't make it any less true. In order to engage in foreign direct investment in America, foreigners must get their hands on dollars. After all, one cannot buy a piece of real estate, a stock, or a bond in America unless one has the dollars to pay for it. How do they get those dollars? Just like you and I do, selling goods and services. Every single one of those dollars that we send abroad goes through the current account, comes back to us in the capital account. The capital account tracks the net change in the physical or financial ownership of assets in the U.S. The reason why foreigners are willing to send us so much more in the way of valuable goods and services while we send them comparatively little is because foreigners believe the U.S. is a good place to invest. If they stop believing this, then the current account deficit would disappear. As it is, foreign savers buy American stocks and bonds. They lend to home buyers, home builders, entrepreneurs, governments, and many others. All of this spending creates demand for American employment. As such, there is no loss of demand in the American economy as a result of the current account deficit, which is why employment in America continues to grow. In other words, foreign savers are, in essence, doing the saving that allows Eugene to produce his food machine. Such capital goods are the reason why we're no longer subsistence farmers. Thank you very much. Thank you.